Hello and welcome from my house again. I'm Corey Ryan, and this is another edition of our Facebook Live show that we are now calling Let's Learn with Bruce and Friends. We've condensed it. It used to be Let's Talk, Learn, and Have Fun with Bruce and Friends, and that was a mouthful. We decided that even though we have all the time in the world, as nobody has time to say all of that, we're here today to celebrate all the amazing things happening in Leander ISD, even though our buildings are closed. As we continue to respond to the novel coronavirus known as COVID-19, we still have kids learning, teachers teaching, and amazing things happening in our community. We're here today to respond to questions and answers, to share stories of students, share stories of teachers, share stories of staff, and to get us started, as we always do, his name is in the title. He's our superintendent. Please join me in welcoming Bruce Gearing.
Hi, folks. I'm so happy to be here with you again today. This has become normal for us now, and it seems like my home office has become my normal office. And so it's great to be with you today. It's so unfortunate that I can't see or hear all of you who are out there supporting us and doing the great work in our community. So we have incredible things happening from all of our students, from our teachers, from our instructional support personnel, from our principals, our administrators, our curriculum designers, our technology support team, our custodians, our child nutrition workers. Everybody is pulling their part to do what is necessary to keep us operating and learning remotely in this challenging time. And it's become a little easier, I think, as we go. We've all settled into a rhythm of sorts in our own family lives and in our school work and in all of the work that we have to do to make all of this happen. But it's become a little more normal, a little more rhythmical as we go forward. We're looking forward, of course, to planning and trying to decide what happens next. We know that it's frustrating because we don't have all the answers all the time. And we appreciate sincerely your patience with us as we try to figure out exactly what we do next. We are apologetic for having to have canceled so many events that our students deserve. They've worked so hard for so many years, especially our class of 2020, our seniors. They've had to miss out on a fantastic spring full of great opportunities. And we're really sorry that they've had to miss that. We're sad that they didn't have some of the opportunities that others have had. But we also know that they are getting prepared to go on to a greater adventure and to do wonderful things in the world. And so we know that we're thinking about them and sending our best wishes and vibes to them to make sure that they're ready for their next step. We're also planning very carefully for what happens in the summer and for what happens as we come back to school in August. And so know that we're thinking carefully and having a lot of conversation around what it looks like when we do eventually get to open. As the governor has started to reopen Texas and allow businesses to start to operate under a certain set of constraints, he's still very firmly kept schools closed. But we know at some point in time that we will reopen. And when we do, we need to be ready for what that looks like and how that feels, and keeping us community, our students, and our faculty safe when we do that. And so know that we're having lots of conversations and there's a lot of planning going on around what that potentially looks like. Our hope, of course, is that we will be back together in person in our buildings in the fall and that we'll be able to operate as normal. But we're also preparing for the eventuality that that doesn't happen quite that way. So thank you for being here today. Thank you for sharing with us. Bring your questions. And with that, I turn you back to Corey.
All right. So continue to submit your questions. We're about to jump into hot topics. We kind of are starting to get a feel for what the questions are going to be. And luckily, a lot of the questions that I'm seeing in our Facebook feed will be covered in here. Real quickly, two questions that are not covered that are appearing in our comments. I'm going to go ahead and take off the top here before we run hot topics. One, graduation plans and spring events. We're still waiting. The principals and our assistant superintendent, John Graham, are still planning and putting out plans. We plan to have an announcement on Friday with more details about that. That also includes more details as to when students and staff can expect to get back into buildings to be able to retrieve personal items. So those won't be covered in Hot Topics, but I wanted to hit those off the bat. Now I do want to cue and run Hot Topics. I don't have my air horn ready to go, so I'm just going to say, let it roll, Garrett.
We're getting a lot of questions about that concept of asynchronous versus synchronous learning. I think you saw it in some of the Zoom chats last week. And a lot of parents are asking the question about why can't my kid's teacher just provide, you know, live video daily or on a regular basis where it looks like an in-person lesson. What would you say to a parent who's asking that question about their teacher providing live video?
Sure. So, you know, as many people have heard, right now we are in a remote learning situation, and in some people would even call it an emergency remote learning situation, where we are all on a pretty steep learning curve. The parents, the students, and our teachers. Our teachers are not credentialed to teach online instruction. That was not what they went to university for the most part. And so we've been learning as we go, and we've been really intentional about making sure that, you know, as we started this remote learning experience, that we weren't doing things. We were trying to minimize the amount of new platforms that students needed to learn with, you know, with only online teacher guidance to assist them with, and as well with our teachers. We wanted to begin with a focus on the types of digital platforms and digital resources that they were familiar with, so that they could focus on the content and focus on the student. The other thing about asynchronous versus synchronous is that we wanted to ensure that we gave the maximum amount of access to the lessons and to the teachers teaching by using recordings. That's the asynchronous piece. It's recorded lessons that students could access when it was convenient and when they were able to do so, not only at a specific time. And there are many factors that would, you know, inhibit a student from being able to log on at 8 a.m. every single day, whether you're looking at bandwidth, whether you're looking at three, you know, multiple siblings in the home and parents working, how many devices are in the home, bandwidth. I think all of us have had situations where things are freezing up, and many families, I know my family, we've, you know, called up our cable company and had to purchase increased, you know, a more premium package. And not all of our families can just, you know, have the luxury of picking up the phone and doing things like that, especially if there is an unemployment situation. Or, you know, the other thing is we have healthcare workers, we have first responders as families, and we have received a lot of feedback from families that, you know, my teenage son or daughter is watching their sibling, in some cases toddlers and infants during the day, because, as you know, the preschools and daycares are closed, so that their mothers and fathers can go out and, I'm just going to say, save the world. And we need to be receptive of that. Now, moving forward, many of our teachers have started to experiment with different Zoom meetings for kids, and, you know, scheduled at different times, and then they're recorded so that we can have kind of both synchronous and asynchronous opportunities. And I think those are going very well.
Dr. Bence, there's a survey going out right now. It's continuing on. What is the kind of feedback that is being asked for, and how do you think the teaching and learning team and will be able to collect that feedback, share it with schools, and make improvements?
So first, I would just say that feedback is so important to us. So I appreciate the people who are taking the time to complete the surveys and get that information to us. We will be sharing it out with the Board of Trustees. We'll be sharing it out with our schools. In the short term, we'll be looking for some information about participation rates. We'll be looking for some information about challenges families are facing, so that we can address some of those things right now during phase two of our learning plan. Overall, while we'd be looking at making tweaks to phase two based on some of the feedback, phase two was built with new learning in mind to be durable and to last through May 29th, through the end of the school year. And during that time, we'll be using survey data and other information that we're gathering along with guidance from TEA and the state and Governor Abbott to develop phase three, which would be what does school look like in August as we all return for the fall.
So Kimberly, we've had a lot of questions from parents about special programs. What should services look like for students receiving 504 dyslexia and special education services? And where can parents go if they have questions?
Sure, absolutely. Services are looking different based on every individual student. Just as a reminder, we created lesson plans each week based on individual student needs and individual student goals, accommodations, and modifications written in their plan. And so those are both synchronous and asynchronous. You know, we have some speech therapy lessons that are being used through Seesaw. So lessons are being recorded or skills are being recorded and students are responding so that our speech pathologists can look at the student progress. We've got social skills lunch bunches happening. Our students in dyslexia are recording and practicing their air charts. So it just depends on the student's individual needs, and our staff has worked really hard to make sure that each student's needs are met. So it looks a variety of different ways. They are hosting activities through Google Classroom and secondary. There are some live Zooms on some cases, and so there's a lot of great activities going on. I'm super proud of the work from our teachers, our tracking teachers, our coordinators. If you have questions, we always encourage you to reach out to the tracking teacher or their coordinator, the 504 coordinator. We are taking feedback from our families. That's how we know what's working best. So continue to provide that feedback. Seek out if you have questions. Our staff is here to help.
So the 2021 budget year is the second year of the biennium. So state aid is not going to change. The only unknowns for the upcoming budget year are, will the student growth materialize as projected, and will homeowners be able to pay their property taxes? So those are the two unknowns. But as far as expenditures, it is a very typical budget because your expenditures are based on your revenues. So we are projecting, with what we do know, a $13 million decline in revenues over our original projections in January. But the expenditures don't really change. So we know we have a certain amount of revenues to support the expenditures. And whether we use those expenditures to buy material goods like books and paper and supplies, or we use those dollars to support online instruction, the budget itself doesn't really change. Well, there's definitely a strong fund balance, and that is evident through looking at history. Four out of the five last years, there's been an increase to fund balance. That's going to help offset the deficit that we're projecting for the 2021 school year and help us plan when we know more about what student growth looks like and what funding looks like in the years following 2021. Now, what would happen in years past this biennium in the next legislative session would be results of any substantial funding cuts, and then we would have to react to those cuts and trim our belt, so to speak, and be able to operate and provide educational services with the funds that are available. This isn't like a hurricane event or a loss in oil values that only affects a couple of districts. This is a statewide and a nationwide impact. And so we're all in it together, and we're all strategizing together and trying to determine what will happen. And that's the unknown, not knowing what will actually happen from this.
People who are currently with us, you know, we are moving forward with growth positions for next year. We're opening Danielson. We're moving forward with hiring for Danielson. As we get into the summer and the fall, we will know more about the following year as to what that is going to look like and what our potential budget impacts will be. But for next year, we're going to move forward with hiring as we had intended and expecting the growth. And if we need to adjust in the summer, later in the summer, where we're seeing we're not getting that growth, we can adjust using attrition and positions that have still not been hired for at that point. So we presented a 2% across the board option for the board to consider. During the discussion, knowing that we have potentially hard budget times ahead, we are looking at some other options like a one-time payment based on some revenue parameters. So if we meet revenue expectations, if we get that growth, we would have a one-time payment possibly in the fall to supplement employees. I think given so many unknowns, we're trying to offer the board some options that would give them more flexibility. Knowing that if we, the more we tie the district to a across the board increase, that could position us to have to reduce more positions the following year. So if we have some flexibility in offering maybe a one-time payment as opposed to an across the board raise, we could see maybe not having to eliminate as many positions moving forward.
I know there's been a lot of people who are wondering what they do with their device, their MLISD device, or even their elementary school device that they borrowed. What is the plan for MLISD devices that students have going into the summer and into next year?
So Corey, what our plan is that students with these, any of the devices, whether it's the secondary MLISD devices or the Chromebooks that we have loaned out to elementary students, we're going to let students keep these devices over the summer rather than try to collect them right now. We know that safety is number one, it's our top priority, and so we want to make sure that students have these devices and they're going to keep them over the summer, and then we will work out a collection time once it's safe for us to be able to return in the fall. All of this information is going to be sent out in Friday's update. So parents of both secondary students and elementary students, if you'll just read through all of the details in Friday's update and just let us know if you have any additional questions.
All right. So I'm Luke. I'm 17 and I'm a junior. And something I've been doing is to keep saying is playing basketball a lot. I have a hoop outside my house. And I'm out there like 3-4 hours a day just putting up shots.
I'm Abby. I'm 14, but I turned 15 in like a month. And I've been cooking and baking a lot and going on bike rides and like FaceTiming friends a bunch. And then I still have dance classes on Zoom every night, which is interesting. But yeah.
And your mom's a teacher, right?
Yes.
How's she doing?
It's getting better. She was kind of frustrated in the beginning, just trying to figure out everything, but she's figuring it out and so am I. And then my dad works at a hospital, but he's not like really in it all. He does like other stuff, so he's doing good too.
That's good. I'm glad to hear that. Mr. Garcia, you want to introduce yourself to our Facebook Live audience?
Yeah, hey guys. My name is Anthony Garcia. I'm the broadcast and graphic design teacher at Cedar Park. It's been a lot of fun trying to actually figure out how to get to do broadcast from home, and the graphic design kids been working on their resumes, and just personally been trying to get outside, reading some more, finally some books that have been stacking up. But mostly what I feel like I've been doing is listening to a lot of music and trying to find some good stuff to listen to as I work from home, and it's nice. So
one of the things that was very impressive to me, you know, where CTE might be a little bit different for everybody because you all are so hands-on, but you guys are still doing a broadcast. What's that been like?
It came out after just a few days when we found out we were going to be coming back and just talking to the kids, and they really were all about it and just getting a chance to get back in the grind and occupy their time and really just do what they love, which is, you know, telling stories to students and the community, but then also making some entertaining, lighthearted segments as well to kind of just take the edge off. And so it was hard, but thanks to the technology we have, like Google Drive and, you know, Zoom, it actually was a lot easier than it probably looks like.
What, why and how did y'all decide that you still wanted to do a broadcast, and like what went into, you know, just figuring out how to do it remotely?
I think we kind of all just like worked together was the main thing. And we had every, on our Monday meetings, we kind of like set our schedule for the week and we like plan when stuff needs to be due. And then like the producers are really helping us out. Like if you just like if you text them, they'll usually help you out. So just like working together and like checking on each other and just like helping each other out with everything that we might need.
So how's it different from your normal show? It sounds like a lot of it just collaboration, working with producers and some of your senior leadership. Like what has been really different other than just being at home?
Probably the difficulty of, since at school we have computers with editing programs on it, and we've had to learn how to adapt with phone programs such as like downloading Adobe Premiere on your phones and learning how to edit on what seems to be like a completely new software. So we've been able to adapt with that, and it's coming out very good. The Wolfcasts we've been making are very nice, and it's probably some of our best Wolfcasts that we've made.
What do you think has been, so we've been doing these live broadcasts, and I think the hardest part has been just to hit like tone, right? Like what is the appropriate, people are, you know, this is such a serious situation for so many people, and we're all in this together, but it impacts us all differently. So have you all had any conversations about like what tone and content should look like? What were those discussions like?
Yeah, well, from the beginning, we had already kind of been operating from like a perspective, like in a traditional newscast, you have blocks, like an A block, which is your first one, B and C and so on. And you put the more serious stuff at the top and the lighthearted stuff at the end. And so we decided we're going to split even A and B block, with an A block focusing on news, hard information, the facts, and then the B block focusing on some of our more lighthearted segments. And even with those ones, when we first came back, we kind of pulled away from the humor and more of the entertainment, but like things that are helpful to know. So our sports director doesn't have a lot of sports to cover. So she transitioned into a new segment called Active with Addy. And she was just going over different ways to stay active at home in your own house and ways to be creative and stuff like that. And then we have another segment called Cooking with Claire that they're doing on just some easy things you can cook at home with just ingredients you have. So we took what we were already doing, retooled it a little bit. But then this last week, we kind of did start bringing back a little bit more humor and trying to balance that. But you guys can speak to that as well if y'all want. Abby did a segment as well of just stuff to do around the house.
Yeah, and then also one of our like normal segments, three things, is usually just like information that's happening, but we made it now where it's like three good things that like aren't with coronavirus to kind of just like distract people and like show that there are good things still happening. And so I've done that a couple times, and so have other people, and it's nice because you can just like not talk about it for once. So yeah.
Have y'all noticed any different like people watching or engaging with your content?
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to tell because the views on our videos are up like for our full show tremendously. But then again, you know, you don't have one teacher showing it to a classroom of 30 kids. So those 30 kids are probably, or some of them are watching on their own clicks. And so I do think though parents are a lot more interested as well. And even students that probably weren't very interested to begin with are kind of curious now what's going on and kind of realizing that, you know, they have this personalized, personal focus kind of on their community and their age group newscast ready to tell them what's going on and what they need to know. One of the segments we added was district decisions, which kind of breaks down some of the emails you guys send out and says, okay, we don't care what the elementary schools are doing, we don't care what the middle schools are doing or what this is about. What does that, you know, have to say about the students at Cedar Park High School? And so we really try to dissect that and just pull out what they need to know. So I think people are realizing that they can come to us for that translated information.
So I imagine Luke as a junior, one of those items was the grading system. When we had to change we decided to put in a new temporary grading system change. How did y'all go about communicating that, and what was kind of the reaction that you heard from students about the temporary decision to do passing?
Well, after going with the same grading system since like middle school, it was very kind of tough, and kind of a lot of students didn't really understand how the new grading system would be in place. And I think how teachers kind of explained it, I've got a lot of emails from teachers like the week that it was the new grading system was sent, and they've been really helpful in communicating these kind of new rubrics into our curriculum, and I think they've been, very helpful.
I think it's like easier for the teachers and like for us, especially because we can't like ask some questions. Well, we can, but like it's a lot harder to like clarify assignments and like go over like really in depth things a lot. And so, like, I personally like it, but I think with like if you don't do your work, then it like can affect your whole year. I think that could be like communicate a little better, because I think some people are just kind of like not really doing anything, and then it's like gonna affect them later. So I think it hurts people in that way, but.
Do y'all feel like that's a thing with your peers? Do you feel like overall there's a lot of students who just aren't engaged at all, or what does that look like? I mean, in high school, we think, I mean, y'all are a lot more independent than elementary school kids and even middle school students. But what do you think just of your peers, not naming names, has been like the take to online learning?
I'd say most of my friends, we're all pretty much doing our work. I mean, there's like a couple of people I know who aren't doing it all, but for the most part, I think a lot of people are also bored. So it's like, what else can you do?
Luke, what would you say has been working really well in remote learning? Like, what is one thing, if we have to continue doing this for a long period of time, like what's one thing that you'd say we need to make sure we keep doing?
I think teachers need to keep pushing out like videos and tutorials. And I think I haven't seen a lot of Zoom meetings with teachers recently. The first couple weeks we'd have a Zoom meeting. I would have like 4 Zoom meetings a week, and they just like introduce our curriculum. But right now it's just like they're pushing stuff on Google Classroom, and there's not really like, there's office hours, but I think having set Zoom meetings for different lessons would be more helpful.
What do you think, Abby?
Yeah, I think like you said, at least just having like one a week, because I know for broadcast, since we have that one, it kind of just like sets us up for the week, and like we know exactly what we're doing and like what we should be doing. But then like other classes, I think people can just kind of get sort of lost. And so I think if we just had like one a week on like Monday and Tuesday, it would just like set us up for the week. We could ask our questions, and I think it'd make it a lot easier, especially if I had to do this a lot longer.
What would y'all want somebody to know, Luke? So say I'm a member of the community, I don't have any kids, or I don't have a high school student. What would you want them to know about just kind of what your experience is right now? There's a lot of discussion about, you know, reopening the economy, like starting to move things around. What does it look like for, what would you want them to know from a student's perspective about what your experience has been with digital learning and the situation we're in being a teenager during, you know, a global pandemic?
Yeah, well, it's very hard to explain because it's so different. It's so abstract. And I'd say it's just like everything, this whole kind of pandemic hit very abruptly, and not a lot of people knew how to react. And I feel like it's just adapting. It's just a lot of adapting, just going with the flow, and whatever news comes out, we're all eating it up and just trying to understand this thing more.
Last time we talked to a student a couple weeks ago, and she mentioned that she recently got a job at a grocery store, but I didn't even think, is that something you're seeing friends do now?
Yeah, one of another reporter, Amelia, did a package on students working in grocery stores, and I think a lot of them had worked there before, but then I think some more have like recently started working there doing all this.
I was gonna, some of them are working limited hours now because some of the stores were cutting back hours for the younger kids to allow the older families that need a little bit more, you know, to support their income. It's a primary income to take a little bit more hours than the kids were taking.
As a high school teacher, Mr. Garcia, what would you want, you know, just Texas to know about what teachers are going through right now? Like, I don't think you probably ever imagined having to run broadcast classes remotely. I know that your experience might be different than like an English teacher or a math teacher, but still being in a community, being in a high school, it's got to be a lot different. What would you want people to know about?
I mean, I would want people to know that even though there are a lot of challenges, I think that this whole pandemic has shown that there's a lot of fat in education. And by that, I just mean like extra stuff that should be trimmed off of, you know, just the way that we do things that kind of just make things more complicated than they need to be, that aren't as essential as they seem to be. And so cutting through that red tape and just giving us access to things the way we've been able to get access to, and a lot more trust than I think we had in the past to just run our classes, has been awesome. So that's the pro to me, is I think hopefully this will reveal how much of what we were doing before was probably unnecessary, or our focus was maybe on things that it shouldn't have been on, and that a lot of stuff can just be an email than a meeting. So I've just learned that, you know, we've kind of focused on more specifically on what we should be focusing on, which is the students and their essential learning.
It seems like forever, but we're getting through it and we're doing it effectively. And by showing that, we've been able to keep this class afloat and still be able to do our work without the tools we have at school. And I think just the idea of that is shown how powerful this bond between teacher and student is.
Luke, the real question I want to ask you, in 4 weeks, whose hair is longer?
Oh, mine or definitely yours? I haven't gotten a haircut in about way before coronavirus even hit, so these locks are growing.
As a former news nerd and somebody who just loves journalism, I really appreciated the opportunity to chat with the Wolfcast broadcast crew. Check them out on YouTube. They're putting out a weekly show telling stories of the amazing things and happening in Cedar Park, even while remotely, and just telling the stories of students during this global pandemic, this once in a lifetime, hopefully, situation we're dealing with. We're here, we're going to take a couple questions. We've been able to answer most, if not all of them, in the chat, but I do want to bring some of them to the video here with our superintendent. Dr. Gearing, first off, there's definitely a lot of concern and a lot of thoughts and feelings about what comes next. I know we can't get you a crystal ball, and you know, I don't believe you have the gift of foresight, but what are your thoughts and feelings, and what would you want people to know about what comes next? What does fall look like?
Yes, we know for sure that right now we're shut until the end of school. So the governor's been pretty firm about that, even as he started opening up other entities. For the fall, I think there's potentially three scenarios that we're looking at and planning for. One is, of course, being back full-time physically in our buildings with all of our kids. And we'll be ready for that if we get the opportunity to do that safely for everybody involved. I think the other extreme of that is that we have a second spike, or there's something goes wrong and the virus takes off again and we end up being completely remote, in which case we will ramp up what is right now phase two of remote learning to a phase three of remote learning, where I think we have to have a much more robust system of direct instruction and making sure that we're presenting new material to our students so that they can master the curriculum that is necessary to get through. And I think, of course, the third option is that there's a hybrid model of some kind, which means that some of our kids are back physically in the buildings with us and there's social distancing happening in our buildings, but some of our students are still remote. And so, of course, planning for that and making sure that we understand how to effectively and efficiently use our facilities to make that happen, who gets to be physically in the buildings and can be safe in the buildings with us, and what we do about students whose parents or who themselves are not willing to put themselves at risk and come back into the buildings. And so our teams are planning for all of that and making sure that we're ready for whichever way that eventuality goes. What this is teaching us for sure is that we have to be flexible and adaptable. And so we'll continue to do the very best we can to keep you up to date on where we are and in our planning process.
One of the things that I love about living in this community and working in this community is just how caring people are. Kim is one of our viewers right now, and she brought up two very good points. One, she shared there's a Facebook page, I guess it's been created, to adopt a senior to help provide that recognition to our class of 2020. And as we know that they're going to miss out on some major life milestones, or not get their major life milestones in the same way that previous graduating classes have been able to. She also brings up a good question, and I know this is something we've talked about as a leadership team in a grander scheme. Her question specifically about meal balances and the notifications for people who might have outstanding meal balances. Dr. Gehring, knowing that there are different fees and things that need to be collected or are typically collected, and knowing that we're also dealing with a historic unemployment rate in Texas and here in Austin, what would you say to our community members who are concerned about some of those fees and those different items that exist in our school?
That's a really great question and a good point. And I will tell you that we have a balance to strike here between being really fiscally responsible and great stewards of our taxpayer dollars, and at the same time having a lot of understanding and empathy for our families and the situations they find themselves in. So folks, I will tell you that we will ask for fees and other requirements that we have in order to try to recover some of those if possible. But I assure you that we do understand that there are situations that are not in the control of folks, and we are truly empathetic to those situations, and we want to work with you in the very best way we can. We do have a number of organizations who are stepping up and who are volunteering to help families and students of LISD who find themselves in difficult positions. And so we urge you to reach out to us. If you have any circumstances that you need help with, please reach out to us and ask for help. We can't help you if we don't know that your challenge exists. And so if you let us know what your challenge is, we can set wheels in motion to really try to reach out and see if we can help or if there's some entity in our community who can help. And we want to really make your situation the best it can possibly be. So don't hesitate to reach out and let us know what you need.
Thank you, Dr. Gehring. Update 24. It is our 24th COVID-19 response update on Friday. It will include information about spring events, MLISD, and the ability for students to get back into buildings, as well as teachers and staff to retrieve personal items. So please be on the lookout for that in your email, inbox, text message, and website, social media channel near you. With that, I'm going to toss it back to Dr. Gehring to share some closing thoughts. And then we have a delightful presentation, performance, dance, song by Reed Elementary School. So we hope you stick around and watch that. Dr. Gehring, leaving people on a beautiful Wednesday in Central Texas, what would you like them to be left with?
Yeah, thank you so much. And thank you, everybody, for taking the time to watch this either live or if you're watching it after the fact. We really appreciate your engagement with the district and continuing to allow us to serve your needs as best we can. One of the things I wanted to share with you was that our students do still have some opportunity to do some amazing things. And one of those opportunities is through advanced placement exams through the College Board. Those exams have been modified slightly, so of course they're not happening in person as they normally would this spring, but they are happening online in a modified format. And so I just wanted to give a strong encouragement to our students who have previously registered for those exams, that would have registered for these in the late fall at their high schools, to make sure that you prepare as well as you can, get as much help as you can, and go and take those exams and do the very best you can. The worst that can happen is that you cannot earn college credit, but of course the best that can happen is that you could earn college credit for those subjects that you're signed up to take AP tests in. So I want to give you a strong encouragement to not forego that opportunity. Work hard, do the very best you can, take those exams. I think you have a great opportunity to save some money as you head to college. And certainly that is something that you should plan to do. Thank you for listening. Thank you for being with us. And I'm looking forward to seeing our student performance. Have a great evening. Listen, baby. Ain't no mountain high. Ain't no valley low. Ain't no river wide enough, baby. If you need me, call me.